You're listening to the Unwritable Rant podcast with your host, author, and occasional misanthrope, Juliette Miranda. Go to theunwritablerant.com and you can subscribe on iTunes or connect with the show on Facebook and Twitter.
Well, hey there, y'all. This is Juliette Miranda, and welcome to episode number 25 of the Unwritable Rant podcast. Today, I am drinking wild turkey. And y'all cannot leave a girl alone with her wild turkey, so please do me a favor, get yourself a glass, fill it up with something strong, and let's say cheers to episode number 25. Woo! That is some potent stuff. I gotta say, though, once again, I am absolutely surprised by the Wild Turkey Distillery. Now, I'm not drinking their classic bourbon. Instead, I have the Wild Turkey Rare Breed Barrel Proof Bourbon. This stuff is potent. The barrel proof means that there's no water added, so it is very, very strong. But it's an incredibly complex drink. Now, I've added a little bit of ice to it to open it up a little bit, and it turns into this wonderful, toasty, nutty, spicy experience. And I swear to God, there's a little bit of dark chocolate in here. And that's only fitting, seeing as how today is, of course, Valentine's Day. Now, don't worry. I'm not going to subject you to any sort of, you know, sentimental nonsense. That's not my style. Instead, I have an interview for you with Anthony Cumia. Anthony Cumia is a broadcast legend. This man has spent decades working in radio. He got a start on FM, he went to satellite radio, and of course, I'm sure y'all know him from his years as the co-host of the Opie and Anthony show. Now, today he's got his own show, the Anthony Cumia Show, and it's on his developing internet broadcast network. If you want to know more about it, just go to anthonycumia.com. Let me tell y'all, though, it's a great show, and I had one hell of a good time interviewing him. We talk about all sorts of things. You know, we got into freedom of speech and the future of broadcasting. And of course, there's some more, you know, colorful conversation in there, too. So, y'all, what do you say? Let's cuddle up. You, me, Wild Turkey, and Anthony Cumia. Well, hello, Mr. Cumia. It's Juliette.
Hey, how you doing, Juliette?
Doing good. Thanks so much for being a guest here on my Valentine's Day episode.
No problem. Valentine's Day, huh? That's great. Yeah, I don't think much about Valentine's Day.
Well, I was going to say nothing says love quite like an interview with Anthony Cumia.
Yeah, exactly.
So to get things started here, I kind of wanted to go back a little bit. You've started in traditional FM radio, moved to satellite, and now you are essentially dominating the internet with your own broadcast network of sorts. You've got 300 episodes of the Anthony Cumia Show done. How's this new format working out for you?
It's great. It really is. I got into it at first sort of like a lifeboat. I mean, when you've been tossed off of terrestrial radio and then tossed off of satellite radio, there's not many places left. So you pretty much have to kind of make your own place. And initially, that's what my plan was, just a place where I could broadcast and do a show from. And then it's kind of turned into a thing where a lot of other people are coming over and saying, hey, I kind of like the idea of having the freedom to say whatever I want without this overhanging threat of some media boss coming down on me or maybe firing me because of my viewpoints or language or, you know, offensive things that I might say. And people are finding it pretty attractive.
Well, yeah, I think it's very cool that you've created a show where you essentially have absolutely no boundaries. But I'm wondering kind of, you know, with the way that society sets its own boundaries, you know, they've got their own way of determining what's okay. How do you kind of balance that freedom you have and, you know, still maintain an audience and, you know, get new listeners at the same time?
I think a lot of people would be surprised how much more people would, especially an audience, would like you to push the envelope, would like you to really shake things up and maybe elicit a gasp or two for things you say, some surprises, things that have just been gone from terrestrial radio. I mean, completely gone. And even satellite radio, my tenure over there kind of proved a point that their whole sales pitch of satellite radio being this last bastion of free speech was just a bunch of crap. There's, you know, shareholders, there's a board of directors, there's a CEO, and all the people that can take what you say, disagree with it, be offended by it, and then throw your ass right out of there. So the idea of doing this on my own and bringing like-minded people in that really want to be able to express themselves, it just seemed like the thing to do. And the people listening and watching, actually, it's all HD video too, they do seem to appreciate it. I think people are fatigued these days. They're just tired of all the political correctness and all the restrictions put on their entertainment these days in the name of, you know, not offending anybody.
So is there anything that's off limits with your show?
I like to say no. I don't think there is. It's not just, hey, because we can, let's just throw the most rank, nasty stuff out there. But the point is, if something does come up in context, I feel that there shouldn't be any restrictions on any subject matter. You know, you wouldn't just blurt certain things out in a church that you might blurt out at a party with your friends. There's basic common sense. You know, if you're joking around, making jokes, I think anything is up for grabs. And if you're discussing news topics that are sensitive, maybe racially based, sexually based, things like that, I don't think there should be any restrictions. We constantly hear about the need for open and honest discussions about sensitive topics. And then the second somebody starts doing it, you know, people scream and ask for someone's job or some type of punishment. They're requesting apologies. So to be able to actually speak about these things, I think it's important.
Well, and what I love about your show is just how honest and in a way unmerciful you are. But it's always done with wit and humor, so it doesn't come off as being mean-spirited. And I think that's the distinction.
Yeah, I never want to try to be Rush Limbaugh or Sean Hannity or O'Reilly or anything like that. I've never wanted to just be a straight-laced kind of talk show guy with serious topics and opinions. I do have opinions that I like to voice, but I'd rather be having fun. Sometimes people do get confused. They think you're pontificating or preaching, and you realize, you know, maybe you haven't put enough fun in it, and you go in the other direction and have a little more fun with the topics and subject matter. But you know, it's a balance. It is kind of nice though to be able to handle those topics and kind of make jokes and have guests in that get it and also want to, you know, hit a few sensitive topics, let's say, with humor. Yeah, it's pretty unique.
Now, I know you've talked about this before, but Twitter has just launched its Trust and Safety Council. You know, some people are praising it, saying it's exactly what the world needs, and then others are saying it's the end of Twitter. What's your take?
I hate anything that has any kind of committee that is picking it apart. And now, you know, they're a public company, and they have, again, CEOs and a board and all that. So it's their prerogative to make Twitter what they want. But to have all these feel-good groups and so many hands in the soup, it takes away from that kind of open discussion again. And the weird thing is, it doesn't take away all of it. I mean, you could still bash certain topics or bash certain people or ideology. So it becomes agenda-driven based on who the bigwigs are over at Twitter, how they handle what they would deem hate speech or offensive language. You know, you got to either have it all or none of it. You can't just take your own ideology and plaster it on something like Twitter, which is this giant, open, worldwide community, and then say, you know, this is acceptable, but this isn't. Yeah, I don't get it.
No, and I think people have definitely lost the idea of context, and when they see things on Twitter or even just in the news in general, you know, it's it's not thinking critically anymore.
Yeah. The context has been something that has just been lost over the past few years. Everything that is deemed offensive is bad, and it's all in the same category. No one thinks that this was comedy, this was commentary, this was news, this was said by an anchorman, this was said by a comedian. All of those things have a context to them. And we as people should know that a comedian saying something is completely different than if your doctor said it or if a politician or a journalist said it. But we've lost that. Talk about race and people don't agree with you and they call you a racist, regardless of who you are, regardless if you have any power or you're just a comedian, which, context is one of the most important things when you are doing comedy. People have to realize you're making jokes. And that's just a loss. It's lost on a lot of people now.
Do you consider yourself a comedian?
Not in the literal sense where, the guys that get up on stage every night and get in front of a mic and a crowd, and I'm amazed by that. That amazes me. It just seems like the most frightening thing to do, wondering as you're saying something if there's going to be a laugh at the end of it or not. And if there isn't, how do you then go on to the next one and stay up there for that long if things aren't working? To me, it's just frightening. So in that sense, no. And I would never take that moniker because I respect comics so much. I think I'm a comedic broadcaster, more so. I think my forte is definitely behind a microphone that's being broadcast out in some way, shape, or form instead of being there in front of a live crowd. But yeah, like a comedic broadcaster, I think. Doesn't sound funny, but that's pretty much what it is.
Well, I mean, in the end, it's still just you and you're broadcasting live with, people watching you. So it's a small distinction, but I think it comes down to storytelling also, which is what I love about a good comedian. It's just how well they engage you with their whole story.
Yeah. I mean, to be able to tell a story it's a talent. It really is amazing. And you realize it when someone's just telling a bad story.
Yeah.
You realize, oh, that's how it's not done. It's gotta grab someone's interest. It's gotta have a rhythm to it and a crescendo and a finish. It can't be too long, but you need the details in there. And it really is concocting a story, especially a true story, to make something that happened to somebody funny. It's a talent. And when you watch people do it well, it really is great to listen to and to laugh to.
So how do you go about determining then what goes into your show every day? Because you do it lasts, what, like two-ish hours, four times a week?
Yeah, it's 4 to 6 Eastern time, Monday through Thursday. So it's usually news-driven, topical stories that are happening, whether it's politics, especially now with the election all over the place, and things like pop culture, TV and movies. I love that. I love looking back on classic commercials or TV shows, things like that. I try to hit on a lot of things that people in a pretty wide demographic can get into. And then even when you're talking about something that you don't think people can directly relate to the story itself, there's got to be some common factor in where they live. If you're talking about, like, I'm driving in or talking about traffic or taking the train or something, it doesn't matter that it's the Long Island Railroad or Long Island Expressway here. People, they have their own hell to drive through or commute to work to where they're from. And, it's just stuff like that. Similar things people can relate to. Family stuff, growing up in a suburb with a, kind of crazy family life. Things like that people can relate to. Just telling stories about my life or guests then jumping on board and talking about their family life or when they were kids, school, the awkwardness of things like that. People seem to really kind of gravitate toward that stuff. And that's like the go-to material. Secondary stuff, if I have to pull from a news pile of things, I really do like weird stories, not your typical ones that any morning zoo would hit, but I'm fascinated with teachers that have sex with their students. And not so much just that the subject of it, but like, who rats that out? Like, what dumb kid spilt the bean? Like, I love finding out the details of those stories, or realizing that the much more attractive teachers get barely any time than the less attractive ones that seem to go to jail for a while. And how is that happening in courts and no one's really noticing it? So just taking basic stories in the news and giving them a little unique viewpoint on it. Yeah, that's a lot of fun.
Do you find it more liberating now to be, you know, sort of a single host versus working with a partner?
Most of the time, I do like having a guest in there and having a comic come in, but it is my show. You know, I am the host and I don't have a sidekick per se. Some comic guests that are on are really very good at kind of taking that role for one day, for one show. But it's not something I depend on a daily basis. And I'm pretty comfortable with doing the show by myself and running through topics, taking phone calls. The fact that it's video, I love the way we could just cut right to a video and comment on it and play it. It's so much better. With radio, it was impossible. Everything is so visually oriented now online. I mean, there's a video for everything. And to be able to play it instead of having to describe it on the radio, it just seems such an archaic way to do things. So, you know, having fun with that, and, you know, if a car chase comes on, to be able to just pop that on the screen behind me and comment on things that are happening at that moment is pretty cool. There was a shooter, an active shooter in one of these cities, and it was happening as my show is on. And I turned on a police scanner app on my phone and was watching the video on one of the news channels. And we were about 10 to 15 minutes ahead of what the news was broadcasting.
Wow.
As far as what was going on. So there is a really interesting take on being able to get things out there that quickly, not being a journalist or not having to have any journalistic fact-checking or back-checking, you know, hey, throw it on, figure it out yourself kind of a thing. It does give you a certain freedom. I never knew starting my own business would be something that I would look forward to on a daily basis going in. I just thought, hey, I want to do a show. But this is really cool, building this whole kind of new medium. I've learned a whole bunch, and it's really interesting and still fun to do the show. So a lot of surprises over the past year and a half or so.
Oh yeah, you're really sort of pioneering almost a new medium for people to see what's going on in the world and getting a different perspective on it. I think that's fascinating.
Yeah, there is plenty of podcasts out there, but it could be anything from a slick show like, you know, Mark Maron's doing a very good podcast. Mm-hmm. He gets amazing guests. He's had, you know, the president on. And then there's some kid in his basement with PlayStation headphones and microphone doing a, you know, podcast. It doesn't mean they're all good or all the same.
Right.
But I wanted to go the next level and, you know, really make it look professional, HD video, have great sets for the shows, the different shows that are on, and, you know, make it, not only are the people doing the shows very talented and fun and funny and interesting, but I wanted it to look like, oh my God, somehow these maniacs got a hold of a professional studio.
It's like the next generation of pirate radio.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you shouldn't see these people saying the things they're saying in such a professional-looking setting. So I kind of like the mixture of that.
Now, you've essentially turned your home into your office. How do you make that separation between work and home? I mean, do you ever kind of just feel a little bit like Jack Torrance in The Shining?
Yeah, initially, I was doing the broadcast from my house. I had a studio in my basement that I had built while I was still working at Sirius Satellite Radio, because I just liked the idea of video broadcasting. So every so often, I would go into my basement, go to the studio, fire it up, and do a show for, you know, the people that were, I would tweet out to, and they'd tune in, and I'd take calls. I had a complete studio built in my basement. So when I got fired, that was handy to be able to have a quick turnaround time to get back out there and broadcasting before too much time went by. But after about a year of that, it just got too nuts having so many guests coming out to my house on Long Island and other shows broadcasting at, you know, 11 midnight.
Right.
Gank would come over and do their show and then jump in my pool, which was fine. Like, I loved it.
Sure, but that never ends.
That's to be a little much. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It never ends. It gets to be a little much. So, me and Keith, who's a producer for the show, decided mostly for guests that we should build a studio in the city. So we got a place and from the ground up built a state of the art HD video studio at 35th and 7th in Midtown, Manhattan. And we rent it out when we're not using it. Neil deGrasse Tyson does Star Talk from there, and we have a few other shows that are just, you know, renting, and they love the video capability, and it's working out nice. And I get to like have a time where I leave my house and then come back to my house like a real human being. So
right,
that helps.
So, what's coming up next then for your show?
Well, I'm hoping to do a little more pre-produced stuff when the weather gets a little nicer. We are in New York City. It offers a great opportunity to get out there and do some stuff outside the studio and finding some more talent. You know, I like the idea of growing this, putting more shows on the platform. They have to be the right shows. Like, I'm not just going to grab up a bunch of shows and have quantity. I really want shows that fit. Mm-hmm. I like irreverence. I like controversial things like that. Gavin McGinnis is a perfect example. He does the show from 10:30 to about 12:30, I guess. And he's great. He's very, very controversial. He says a lot of things that people might not agree with, and I love it. East Side Dave, I used to work with him over at Sirius Satellite Radio and over at K-Rock and XM Studios. And he's fantastic. He fits this platform. Pat Dixon is another one that's great, and Legion of Skanks. So looking for more shows to fill up more of the day is a plan. And, you know, just keeping it growing and building.
Well, and I'm sure people are wondering, too, when we're going to see a show from Jim Norton or Ronnie B.
Yeah, they unfortunately have shows over there at the Satellite. But you never know what the future might bring. Contracts expire, people sign or don't sign, to move on to other things. So we're always open to have old friends come by and see how that works out. So yeah, it's exciting because I know that what we're doing is this growing new medium, and everything else is kind of old hat now. I mean, even satellite radio, the lifespan there between them being the only alternative to radio and them just being kind of an older version of what we have available to us on a daily basis through things like Pandora and just a multitude of entertainment is available to people on demand out there. So even satellite is kind of old at this point. So being part of a real growing new part of broadcasting is exciting, and I think a lot of other people are excited by it and would love to come over, and I don't think it's going to take too long before that starts happening.
So to close things out, I've got one final question for you, and I think it's something that is definitely on a lot of people's minds. Want to find out, what do you hate more, Twitter or Periscope?
Well, yeah, I'm not a big fan of Periscope, that's for sure. But I think I would hate Periscope more because it's so... We thought Twitter was immediate. And, you know, you post something and put it out there. But at least, I mean, I've taken some of my tweets right before I hit send and thought to myself, you know what? Nah. Sometimes it's like I just don't feel like putting that out there and getting into it. 3-hour argument with people over it. Other times it's like, you know, that person, it's their opinion. Why am I shitting all over it when they didn't even kind of direct you toward me. Other times I'm just, you know, it's not a good tweet. Periscope, oh my God, it's just immediate. There's no dump button. It's from it happening to being out there for everybody. And I think that's dangerous.
It is, and it never goes away.
Yeah, exactly. Well, they're both very dangerous in their own ways, but that Periscope, man, if you're looking to have a private moment in your house, perhaps, it's pretty goddamn dangerous.
Well, Anthony, thank you for sharing with us. I really appreciate you being on the podcast today. It's been a blast talking to you.
No problem. I loved your interview with Damone from Fast Times. It was fantastic. I like that he addressed the whole iced tea thing. Hey, you know, he was kind of nervous.
It was a trip talking to him. Just hearing that voice the entire time.
It was really good. It was a really, really fun interview to listen to. And that, then when you approached me to do your show, I'm like, yeah, sure, man.
Well, I was very happy to hear that.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you. And happy Valentine's Day to you too, Anthony. Cheers.